So as the situation in Afghanistan worsens, India and Indian assets in Afghanistan also at risk. After the fall of Herat, the Taliban captured the India-Afghanistan Friendship Dam, or the Salma Dam, which was inaugurated by Prime Minister Narendra Modi and the Afghan President Ashraf Ghani in 2016. So it's not just Indian assets that are at risk. Pakistan-backed Taliban could prove to be a serious security concern for India and Indian interests.
India has joined Germany, Qatar and Turkey in calling for an immediate ceasefire in Afghanistan and asserting that any government imposed by military force in Kabul will not be recognized. As Afghanistan's descent into absolute chaos continues, Indians and Indian assets are already under attack. The Ministry of External Affairs has advised all Indians working in Afghanistan to not only register with the Indian embassy in Kabul, but also return to India till the situation stabilizes. The Taliban racing to power in Afghanistan will have major consequences for the region. India has already invested more than $3 billion in aid and reconstruction activities in the country, from their parliament building to schools, hospitals, roads, infrastructure and dams. Taliban have already captured an Mi-24 attack helicopter that India had gifted to Afghan forces in 2019. However, reports suggest that Afghan forces removed the blades of the helicopter before surrendering to Taliban so that it cannot be used by the terrorists. One of Afghanistan's biggest dams, the Afghan-India Friendship Dam on the Harirud River in Herat, has also been captured after the fall of the third largest city. Inaugurated by Prime Minister Modi and Ashraf Ghani in 2016, it was the main source of electricity and irrigation water for hundreds of thousands of people in western Afghanistan.
All violence must come to an end. And ties with international terrorism should also be cut. And we cannot have terrorist camps once again moving back into Afghanistan. And this will have a direct impact on India. It's important for us to protect the gains which we have had in the last nearly 20 years.
Main players in Afghanistan and
a hostile power in Kabul would be advantage Pakistan. The pro-Taliban sentiment in Pakistan is growing stronger, which may try to harm India in the near future. India's main challenge, however, will come when Pakistan ships the terror training camps of terror groups like Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed to Taliban-occupied Afghanistan for future terror strikes against India.
Right now, the onus is on Pakistan to create such a conducive atmosphere, including by taking credible and verifiable action not to allow any territory under their control to be used for cross-border terrorism against India.
A China-Pakistan-Taliban alliance might become an insurmountable national security challenge if China is able to integrate Afghanistan into BRI and CPEC and fully exploit its natural resources. India's leverage in the region will weaken. Bureau Report, India Today.
Ambassador Kaju, given the ground realities in Afghanistan at this point of time, should India be engaging with whoever is in power? If it's the Taliban, engage with the Taliban.
Well, I've been saying for the last 4 years and more that we should engage the Taliban. Today, do you have an alternative? Do you want the Taliban should be shunned, especially if the international community is going to engage? In the 1990s, the Taliban were shunned. Only three countries engaged them.
Yes.
Or recognized them. That was the UAE, Pakistan, and Saudi Arabia. The UN seat was held by President Rabbani's government, even though the Taliban controlled 90% of the territory and more.
Yes.
Today, the 12 countries in the Doha meeting said that the Taliban government will not be recognized, will become a pariah government if it comes in by force. At the moment, the Taliban are on the outskirts of Kabul, and there is apparently some kind of a negotiation going on for a quote-unquote peaceful.
Yes.
I'm emphasizing quote-unquote peaceful handover of power, just as power was handed over to them in the other major cities, in Herat, in Kandahar, in Mazar-e-Sharif, and Jalalabad. Now, if all this transpires, we don't like the Taliban. Naturally, the Taliban's ideology is antithetical to us. The Taliban have close contact with the Pakistan.
Yes.
But if the Taliban are forming the government and the Chinese, the Russians, and everyone else recognizes them, then the question I ask is a simple one. Should we, in diplomatic sullenness, keep away, or should we engage them, inform them of our red lines, tell them that if they are in cahoots with any other power inimical to India, India knows how to defend its interests and has the resilience.
The Prime Minister seemed to indicate that.
Gaurav,
yes, go
Gaurav,
on, sir.
One last point.
Go on,
the
sir.
The fact that we have spent $3 billion has been in creating assets for all the Afghan people without any favoritism. And the Taliban are aware of this.
Yes.
We built roads, we built transmission lines, we built the parliament building, we built hospitals. And given that, I don't see the Taliban destroying these assets, even if Pakistan asks them to destroy
these
assets.
That's a good point you've come to. In fact, General, there is an India connection of one of the Taliban leaders, Sher Abbas Stanikzai, trained at the Indian Military Academy, Dehradun. So I'm sure there are those links that can be perhaps explored to see how Indian interests in Afghanistan are best served.
Okay, very interesting points brought out by Ambassador Kachu, and I agree with him. The fact is that I think the whole game that they have played across in the course of last year or so, Taliban is seeking to bring about a legitimacy to their regime when it takes over. And it's an international legitimacy. It starts from Doha, but it goes across there. So they may get a regime which is, on the face of it, very moderate in nature. Mr. Jalali, if you say, and as Ambassador Kadri was pointing out, he is taught in Washington's National Defense University for a long time.
Yes.
So he's a Western diplomat. So there will be a face for it. And then there will be people who will run the strings like Akhundzada or Mullah Omar's son or Sirajuddin Haqqani and all, who are the actual movement behind it. So there is a legitimacy to come across here. And second issue I wish to raise is about the assets. So the assets that we have made, we have no control on them. These assets were handed over to the Afghan government.
Yes.
We did great benevolent gesture, but they are Afghan assets now. They are no more our assets. Neither the road nor the dam. They are Afghan. If they want to destroy it, it's an Afghan assets being destroyed. And my last point is here that I think we need not get overboard with what we want to do with Taliban, start talking now, or let's wait and watch. Things will develop. Things will move on.
Okay.
We don't have to be in a hurry to putting our cards on the table.
The point is we shouldn't be left out either. Others engage with them and we are left out or the last to catch up. I mean, it's just a point that I'm trying to raise. But, last 30 seconds that I have on the broadcast, Ambassador Kadju, within the Taliban, are they all with Pakistan or there are groups that may listen to Pakistan and groups that may be hostile? And even within the Taliban, will there be friction in the days and weeks ahead?
Look, the Taliban, once they form a government, will behave like a government. My worry is not that. My worry is that the Chinese will now make a play for Afghanistan, not making the mistakes that the Soviets and the Americans did. Because if you look at India's Western neighborhood, it's getting very critical.
Yes.
The Pakistanis are in China's pocket. It's a client state. The Chinese are making a play for Iran in a very big way, as we mean. $400 billion investments thought of in 20 years. The Chinese are entrenched, in a manner of speaking, economically in Central Asia. The missing link is Afghanistan. Do you think they'll... they leave Afghanistan and think of the photograph where yes. Wang Yi, the state counselor and foreign minister, was welcoming a Taliban delegation.
Wang Yi,
that is the worry that I have. So that means that we shouldn't lose any time in engaging the Taliban.
Very pertinent point you made there, sir.
Wait and watch for what?
Very, very pertinent point you make, and we will debate this in the next several days and weeks ahead. I've run out of time on this part of the show. General Rakesh Sharma and Ambassador Kadju, many thanks for joining me. A quick break. For all the news and updates, log on to indiatoday.in. You can also download the India Today app.